Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome aboard. This is Claire from New Venture Corporation, the organizer of today's webinar. The solar business in Thailand is booming, and the government prepares to hit its Paris Climate Accord target of 30% renewable by 2030. And private businesses seek to attract green investors by matching ambitious emission reduction targets. Due to government enthusiasm and a variety of other factors, we can say Thailand's solar energy market has huge growth potential in the near future. So today, we are honored to invite industry players to discuss about the state of course trend in Thailand's solar market. First of all, I would like to give a brief introduction and big welcome to our speakers today. They are Mr. Joseph Tomkiewicz, partner of Coach Air Energy Practice from Gilkin and Gibbons. Joseph has over 13 years of managerial, transactional, and litigation experience in the world's largest publicly traded oil and gas companies. He has lived and worked in Thailand, Nigeria, Bangladesh, Qatar, Saudi Arabia, Texas, New York, Washington, D.C., and Louisiana, and Florida, during which time he has served as an officer, director, and general counsel to several affiliated overseas oil and gas companies. Ms. Rui Xizhang, Jinko's global project from Jinko Solar. Rui Xi has over focusing on addressing the global market need to deliver a differentiated product to explore viable business opportunities. And she's also the product manager for Tiger Pro series launched last year, as well as the latest series Tiger Neo. And next, Rose Shen. Rose Shen is the sales manager of Thailand at Arctech. She has more than 10 years of strong experience in the PV industry, with proven skills at building teams and delivering strong financial results in APAC regions. With a trackable record of 1 gigawatt projects in the solar tracker industry, she is specialized in providing various solar tracking solutions with different types of modules. In the past 5 years, as a female team leader in the solar industry, she is passionate for renewable energy technology, empowering mission-focused and thrilling culture of Arctech team in Thailand. And Spencer Xu. Ms. Spencer Xu graduated from the University of Melbourne, is schooled with solution engineering of SEA and Australia region. Spencer started her PV industry career in Australia, and now she's focusing on providing differentiated and customized PV system solutions. Spencer devoted herself to the renewable energy industry because of her understanding as responsibility for environment protection. Next, Mr. Fabian Shedford. Fabian Shedford is a country manager for LYS Energy Thailand with a 10 year of experience in solar, photovoltaic and energy efficiency through many pilot projects and large scale implementation. He's supporting the development of the company in the newly established and fast-growing Thailand market. He has been developing solar projects across Thailand since 2015, with responsibilities ranging from business development to head of engineering department. He followed closely the evolution of the regulation as well as the solar market. He helps develop the Thailand branch of an international and independent power producer. Last but not least, Mr. Komsong Konyotha. Komsong has more than 10 years of experience in solar power business, have a cross side of business aspect from PV module, engineering, procurement, and construction of solar plant, investment and development of solar power projects. He developed more than 150 megawatts solar PV project in Thailand, including ground-mounted solar, floating solar, and rooftop solar. Successful development Thailand's self-consumption and corporate PPA business model. For today's webinar, we will have two minutes plenary speech by Jinko Solar and Arctech, and then we will have a 14 to 45 minutes panel discussion. And then the next session will be a plenary speech by Goodwill Solar. The organizer of today's webinar, Neo Venture Corporation, is dedicated to supporting key investors and developers for successful development and investment in Asia-Pacific renewable energy sectors. Our footprints cover Asia-Pacific countries such as Vietnam, Philippines, Thailand, China, Myanmar, Australia, Malaysia, Singapore, and some Middle East countries. Before starting the webinar, I would like to introduce our attendees with some housekeeping notes. If you experience any technical issues or have questions for speakers, please use the below Q&A box. Now, let's welcome our first speaker today, Rishi Zhang, Global Project Manager from Jinko Solar. Let's welcome.
Okay, thank you for the introduction. My name is Rixi Zhang from Jinko Solar Global Product Management Team. And today is my great honor to be the first guest speaker and talking about how we understand the Thailand market and how our modules can fit this particular market. Here, I would like to introduce our newest product, which is launched in this month as Tiger Neo. It is N-type popcorn technology module, and I'd also love to introduce how it can fit in different application scenarios. First, please allow me to have a brief introduction of Jinko Solar. Jinko Solar is a mature manufacturer in the industry who is the one and the only company can be the number one shipment for the continuous 4 years globally. And so far, our module has delivered for more than 80 gigawatts, and the market share has reached more than 14.3% globally. And our R&D laboratory has break 18 world records. And our total module capacity has reached 45 gigawatts after we adding up with 10 gigawatts of N-type capacity. Here is our global layout map. Here we can see we majorly allocate in Asian area. There are 11 production facilities in Asian regions. And here from the market share ranking, we can see that Jinko Solar have the biggest market share in 8 of the top 10 PV markets in 2020. This indicates that Jinko Solar has been focusing on providing the product portfolio that can fit the diverse market and the different demands and the environment.
Maybe I could interrupt everyone to put their microphones on mute. I apologize. We are getting a little background noise. If you're not speaking, there we go. Thank you. Sorry, Rishi.
Okay. Thanks, Joseph. I got a little bit lost. Where am I? And here. Okay, let's continue. Looking at the roadmap, I'd love to have a brief review of the history of Jinko products and the whole industry products. It is very obvious and significant from this roadmap. The power and efficiency is growing along the time, but there is only one time, which is 2015 to 2016. The power increase is due to the technology change from poly to PERC. Afterwards, since 2016, the whole industry and Jinko is increasing their cell size to adding up the module power. And this will lead to the module is getting bigger and bigger. But is it the only way and the best way to increase the module power and boost the industry? This is a question mark. And we have been thinking about this question for a while. Oops. So what is the key for this industry? I believe is plant LCOE is the benefits of the end customer and how LCOE was calculated. From this formula, it is clear there are two major elements. The one is the power generation in the whole lifespan, and another is our whole cost during the years. The initial cost absolutely will impact it largely by the module power and efficiency. When the module power is increased, there would be fewer mounting and cable cost, because once the single module's power increase, the total pieces will be decreased. So the mounting and cable cost can be decreased accordingly. And however, if the module is getting bigger, it will be more difficult to be installed. There will be higher labor cost. And when the module is getting bigger, there will also higher mechanical load risk. So the mounting cost could relatively increase as well. So although generally when module power increase, BOS cost can decrease, and this relation will be affected by a lot of criteria. So that's why in 2020 and 2021, there are many debates and arguments about 182 and 210 modules, which is the best size. And from the O&M cost, also when the module efficiency increases, the land cost will decrease, but also impacted by the size. So here, Jinko Solar decided to jump out of the sizing game. We'd like to keep the size as 182 modules size, but increase the power by 15 watt peak. So here we can say that there would be clear module power increase and the cost decrease relation in this formula.
So, Rishi, are you showing slides right now? Because I'm not sure if we see them. I apologize for interrupting. Claire, okay. Maybe you could.
Yes, I am sharing. So can you see the LCOE formula here?
Yes, we can.
I cannot. Okay, good. Thank you.
Okay.
Great. Thank you.
Okay, I'll continue. So, yes. So we are looking at the N-type technology to realize improving the power without changing the size. Here from the line chart, we can see from the blue line is the records of N-type cell efficiency, and the black line is the P-type cell efficiency. It is clear that N-type cell efficiency is increasing linearly, but for P-type, since 2020, the slope is getting smaller, which means the increasing is getting slower. That is because the P-type cell efficiency is getting closer to the efficient limits. And this will lead more difficulties, increase the module power by the natural efficiency growing of cells. However, for N-type, the efficiency limits, cell limits is 28.7%. And at this stage, the mass production efficiency is only 24.5%. So there are still 4% to go. And that means our N-type cell have a really long lifespan, and it will be the dominant technology and the dominant modules in the next 4 or 5 years. And here is classification of these kind of different cell technologies. From the very beginning, we're all familiar with is the P-type, including the poly and PERC. And then we go to the N-type. The first generation is PERT, which Jinko has been using the PERT technology in our 158 module, which is familiar as Cheetah N-type. And then we go to the second generation. There are two major technologies being discussed in the second generation, which is TOPCon and HGT. For TOPCon, the technology determines the maximum efficiency by having the passivation. The passivation will allow the majority carriers pass and lead to decrease the resistance loss. And also the minority carriers will be restrained, and the carrier recombination will be decreased as well. So the general efficiency will increase. And here, what is doing the most help in this passivation, it is the tunneling layer, and which is also the major difference with TOPCon and HJT and PERC. Both TOPCon and HJT achieve their power improvement by passivation, but the TOPCon uses the tunneling oxide layer, while HJT uses intrinsic amorphous silicon film. The difference is the right layers. For the HJT, this method will request modify the production line very largely. And this will result in a huge difference in the commercial cost. For HJT, it will cost more, about 0.3 Chinese yuan per watt comparing to TOPCon. And that is why the most tier one players is looking at the TOPCon technology other than HJT, because they can use their original PERC production line to be modified to the TOPCon. However, HJT need to establish new production lines or invest a lot of cost to have the HJT production line. And I believe here you must be very interested. Since we're using the N-type cells, what is the final advantage for the modules? The first and the most significant product advantage is the degradation. Here, the first year degradation for the Tiger Neo series is less than 1%, and the linear degradation is 0.4%. Comparing with the traditional P-type products, first year degradation is about 2%, and the linear degradation is about 0.55 or 0.50%. So this huge difference enables that N-type can keep performing well in their whole lifespan among 30 years. But how it happens from technical side, LID is a loss in the barren-doped P-type silicon solar cell. The efficiency is observed during initial light soaking process. The boron oxide complex activated by exceed injection of illumination was indicated the root cause, since boron oxide complex capture bulk minority electron as recombination center. Even hydrogeneration cannot passivate boron oxide complex defects totally. But the N-type cells uses phosphorus stop process. There is no boron oxide at all, so there won't be light-induced degradation. So that's why we can reach the only less than 1% first year degradation. And the second advantage is from our reliability test. By having the one times or two times IEC standard test, we can say that Tiger Neo N-type has better reliability comparing with same cell size and same layout modules, which is our Tiger Pro. And from the bar chart, we can see the blue bars are indicating the Tiger Neo series, and the gray chart and the gray bar is the Tiger Pro. From this chart, it's significant that the more strict the test environment is, the better, the more advantage we can see from our N-type module. And the third advantage, which is, I believe, very much relates to Thailand market. As we all know, Thailand is relatively more warm, is a very warm country. And here, the advantage is about the temperature coefficient. Tiger Neo's power output will increase with a better temperature coefficient by 0.78%, which means N-type cell itself has less sensitive to the temperature. And also, due to our cells have high efficiency, it can transform the irradiance to the power other than heat. So the working temperature of N-type cells is naturally have lower temperature, it will be lower than the P-type. And plus it having the better temperature coefficient, which is 0.3%, comparing with P-type 0.35%, it will have much better performance in especially hot weathers. And the another advantage is about bifacial factor. As far as I know, the Thailand market maybe is not the biggest bifacial market, but I believe it will be. Because in this market, actually the bifacial modules is becoming the trend. That will boost most of the solar providers to produce more bifacial modules. And therefore, the supply chain and the cost will decrease. Eventually, the bifacial premium will get even to the monofacial. So under this condition, even though in Thailand, maybe the slope of the installation is relatively small, so the plant owners consider there are less bifacial gain. But in the future, if the premium is getting smaller, I believe there will be more and more bifacial modules installed in Thailand market as well, especially when our N-type have 15% bifacial factor plus comparing to our P-type. Here is our calculation. It's very simple. The integrated power, which plus the front side and the rear side, when the bifacial factor increase from the P-type 70% to the N-type 85%, the bifacial gain will increase by 2.03%, which is actually very significant for a whole power plant and will significantly decrease the whole LCOE as well. And in general, the first year energy generation, N-type will have 3% more comparing to the P-type due to it having the better degradation and the better temperature coefficients as well as the bifacial gain. Here, our Tiger Neo also uses 182 cell technologies, as I mentioned. There are two major reasons we still stick with 182. The first is from the industrial end. 182 has been a very mature cell size, so it has a very well-developed supply chain from the wafer, cell, and module, so on and so forth. And from the customer size, we believe we remain the 182 module size can have the best compatibility neither with mounting systems or inverters. Here is our product portfolio. First of all, we have launched the biggest power and the biggest module, which is Tiger Neo 78 pieces. The maximum power in 2022 will be 610 watt peak for monofacial, and for bifacial, it will be 605 watt peak. And for this kind of 78 modules, it is relatively longer, but I believe it can be used in Thailand perfectly because considering the labor cost and the land cost and so on and so forth, this big module will decrease the system general BOS cost. And for Tiger Neo 72 pieces, the mass production power in next year will be 565 and 560. And also there are smaller pieces like 60 and 54. They are more suitable for smaller rooftops. And here our capacity in next year will be 10 gigawatt. And the mass production will start from next year since March. And here is one of the outdoor project data support. Here we do the comparison between P-type and N-type bifacial. It's located in China, which is China Zhejiang, which is very southern area. And the temperature is relatively warmer. And here, let's jump to the results. The power generation difference reaches 3%. And we can say the peak here is in September, which we can tell when the temperature coefficient has do the most benefits in this difference. When the weather is getting warmer and warmer, the temperature coefficient can help N-type to perform more benefits comparing to our P-type. And here is our LCOE, one of the LCOE analysis in the utility scale. The initial cost is 0.35% lower than our P-type due to the higher power and higher efficiency. And the internal rate of return will increase by 3.31%, and the LCOE will decrease by 1 Chinese cent. And also considering the power gain, the LCOE will be more significant. And in the residential scenario, here is a 30 kilowatt AC project. The initial cost can save $390. And this is actually a Chinese project, but considering China and Thailand have, China northern area have very similar rooftop layout. So we think this can be used as a reference. Here we can say that, first of all, N-type can generate more power. And since it can only use 7 pieces less than P-type projects, so there will be fewer piles and it will be installed faster. So it can save $300 to $400. So this money probably doesn't mean a lot to a big plant owners, but for the residential, I believe this kind of money saving can boost the local residential market. And for the CNI, we use a very similar layout. Like in China, we also use bifacial modules in the rooftop, where the N-type can save $2,300 to $3,000. And the power generation can gain more than 2,200 kilowatt hours than for each month. So in generally, Jinko N-type products have a better power generation the ability, and which can help with the Thailand markets to boost neither the residential or rooftop market or the utility scales. So that is all my presentation today, and thank you all for your listening. Thanks.
Speaker will be Rose Shen, Sales Director of Thailand from Arctic Solar. Let's welcome.
Hi. Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for giving me this opportunity to let me introduce a little bit our company and our products and the strategy of our future plan in the Thailand market. First, let me introduce a little bit for our company. Arctic Solar is founded in 2009, and our headquarters is in Kunshan, China. Our international set, can you see the slide?
Yes, we can see clearly.
Yeah. Great. Okay, our headquarters is founded in the Kunshan, China, in the Jiangsu province. Our international commercial center is located in Shanghai. So far during the 12 years, Arctic has become the leading manufacturer and the supplier of the of the solar tracking system and the fixed structure in this industry. So far, we have installed over 32 gigawatts project installed in all over the world. Our employees has over 1,000 people. And here is the milestone of our company's history. You can see there's for each year we are developing new kind of technology and new product. Since 2017, Arctic has become ranking the number one supplier of Asia and the Pacific area. And also we ranked the top four were tracker suppliers worldwide. And during these continuous 4 years, we have kept that position and never been lower. And also in the 2020, we have Arctic has become the listed company become going public. Here is the data. For the in Asia Pacific area that we have, we have owned about 35% share in this market. This is our production capability. Arctic has one of the biggest factory for manufacturing the solar structures in the world. We have our factory is located in Changzhou, also in the Jiangsu province. And also we are under construction a new factory, which is even bigger in Anhui province. And it's already started the trial production now. And so far in our production line, we have managed the highly automatic lines. This way we can further reduce the cost of our product. We can have the better, we can provide our product to the market with even better price. And also we further increase the efficiency of our production. That way we can provide the product, we can deliver the product to our customer even faster. Here's the certificate and our patent. We have a very strong R&D and researching team. And over the years, we have reached over 100 patents in our product. And also we are strongly bankability, which means we are listed in the world's major banks. So this is kind of in, further have the, in, added the value of our brand. Here's the global presence. Arctic is, our business is a highly global set business. During the years, we have set up over 12 branches in all over the world, over the four continents. And we have four service centers each, in each continent. That means wherever our customer is and wherever is our project, we can respond to it. Commercially or technically in the first at the first first step time. Here is the tracking our mainstream product. The tracking system, of course, is our main product. We are developing 1P and the 2P system at the same time, and compared to all the other product, tracking products in the world, we have our core competitors, our AI system and our system, our tracker system, they are all independent roles. That means our control system there was highly intelligent. They are learning and from our algorithm and they are doing a lot of works and to adjust with the field with the, this exact site field work. That means our all the project they are all customized to be the most suitable system to provide the solution. And also we our communication system and our powering system they are it's wireless and our power system they are string powered, which means that we have saved a lot of the cable cost for the customer. This is the 1P solution, we call the Skyline. Compared to 2P, this is this product is our most popular product in the solution. And this is also the most acceptable by the customer. First, it's more cost effective. And it's because the system height is very is quite low. So that means it will be easy for customer to install in the at site. And this Skyline system has is one of the most popular, as I mentioned. But as the time goes, the one problem we meet is that for the trend, the module size is become bigger and bigger. We have this over 600 watt, and it's even reached it's about the 700. I think the voltage of the module will be increased very rapidly in the future years. And how to adapt that? Because the tracker system, the length of the tracker, it cannot be added limitedly. It's like extension to the sky. So how can we do that? Limited by the structure, we are we are upgraded to our next generation Skyline 2, and to adjust with the even the bigger and bigger size of the module. This generation has we invented a total different structure design for this product, and in this way it can contains more quantity of the module. We will use like a very creative like the four strings. The design for this tracker, and also it's had the multi-point drone system. So even with the bigger size, bigger and heavier size, the tracker can also be very stable and very flexible. And this is the 2P system we call the SkySmart 2. Its invention is because the module was transferred from monofacial to the bifacial, and because In 2P, there will be no shadow in the backside of the module. So that way we can increase the generation, the output of the backside of the module. So in this way, it's the generation will be even higher. This is a technology of the technology advantage of us so far, because you know, as the wind load, the wind tunnel test is the key to the tracker and tracking system design. And the ARCHTEC is pushing this to the very limit. For it, from the level one static the wind tunnel test, and then we are have the next generation by generation wind test. And so far, this is the most advanced testing. We call it Aero Plus. This is combined with all the different from level one to level four different type of the wind tunnel test. Because we find it for the wind itself, it's not like very stable. It's blowing from one direction. The wind is very flexible. It can be from different direction. It can be from up and down. And it's also like it will blow like a swell. So the wind situation is very, very complicated. And the more we learn, the more we find it's very, very difficult to adjust to it. And for the Aero Plus, it's mostly stimulated to the actual wind situation, to the field. So in this way, we can monitor the different situation of, and this is the most to the real situation. And and please hear and let me announce a good news for us. And ARCHTEC has also established our own wind tunnel laboratory in China. That means we can have
Hello, Rose. I think your internet is break up.
Claire, let's give her 1 second to see if she can recover her internet.
Okay.
This is our new AI control system. And by using this one, it will be increased the traditional tracking solution. It's over up to about 7% to adding on the energy output. This is very creative and black technology, the invention. And because usually this will the tracking system they are using like a astronomical algorithm, and for and the since this generation we have added like the cloud weather monitor the detective algorithm. In this way, it's not only using the program itself, and also it's monitoring the weather situation, how the cloud is coming, how the radiation. So the tracker, independently, each tracker can have is learning from the field weather, and it will adjust and to have the best radiation at the moment to have so it can have the highest output. And also we have the tracker itself, SCADA system. And this way it's mostly using at two sides. One is for the monitoring. It will have a throughout monitor to the tracker itself. And also it can control by the SCADA itself, because when you need to go to the cleaning mode, you can have the one button on the SCADA system and it will naturally turn into the cleaning mode, and also the wind mode in the different mode. And another function is about the data collection. This SCADA system can have the very throughout data collection, and it go into the log to store in your own SCADA and logging system. And also the data can be uploaded to the cloud platform. This way we can, the ARCHTEC can also help you to monitoring the system's data. And if there's any situation you would like us to get involved, and also ARCHTEC can have the most experienced and professional advice for the tracker in the first time. And for despite the product itself, in ARCHTEC, we can also provide a value-added service for the technical, for the before the delivery, we can provide for the most professional and experienced advice and engineering support for the project design. First is we can help to do the PVCs. We can help to suggest for the foundation situation, and we can help with the drawing. During the delivery, we can also help to do the reassembly, so that you can save the time in the real installation at site. Other things, so when during the delivery, we can provide several reasonable spare parts, because we know there will be loss and damage during the construction or during the transportation. Also, there's on-site, we will remotely, or we can send our engineer to the field for the installation advisor, and also we can training for the OAM and for the commissioning. Sorry, I'll make it quick. And also, this is like the schedule for our design and the delivery, because from for Thailand, usually we will ship from our Chinese factory, and the shipping period will be short. It's about 1 to 2 weeks. It's from Shanghai to the Thailand port, but usually we will need more time to do the after we confirm for closure for the technical design, and we will need about totally 2 months for all the technical design and preparation for the material and the production. So we can discuss later. This is for the fixed structure, but for the Thailand, the market that we within there, there's also a lot of fixed structure requirement, and for the Thailand, the radiation in locally that we think trackers will be probably will be a better choice. So at this moment, but we just want to show that Arctech can provide a whole industry chain. And also we can provide like a solar carport and the BIPV, the rooftop system, to help with the different demand of the customer. And here are several projects we have done in Southeast Asia. This one is with 1P, our Skyline system with bifacial module. This is like a 61 megawatts. It's already finished the installation, finished commissioning in Vietnam. And this is a 5 megawatts product we finished in Thailand. This is 2P system. And this is the first tracking system in Thailand so far. This is made by Arctech. And also we have, it's under operation. There's an, I think one of the biggest in Thailand. This is 49 megawatts. It's, we are the production, we're producing right now. And will be installed and commissioning in next year. This is the rooftop. I think also Thailand market has a lot of potential needs for the rooftops, and if there's any demands, we would love to help to design and help to finish the solution. The other things. Thank you very much for listening.
Thank you, Rose. I think our speakers really want to share their experience and the latest technology in this market, and our audience are really benefit from their plenary speeches. Okay, now let's turn to the panel discussion session today, retrospect and prospect, Thailand solar market's potential, state of course forecast to 2025 and vision to 2035. We will have Mr. Joseph Tom Kiwitz, Ms. Rexi Zhang, Ms. Rose Shen, Ms. Spencer Xu, Mr. Fabian Shetford, and Mr. Komsong Kanyusa to have this panel discussion. The moderator will be Joseph. Now I'm going to turn the microphone to Joseph. Let's welcome.
Well, thank you very much, Claire. That was a very good introduction. So you've given the title of the session already. I'd like to thank Goodwee, Jinko, and the organizer, Neo Ventures and Solar Talks webinar, for doing this today. Telecki and Gibbons, as you can see behind me, is a regional law firm. We've been in business for over 120 years, and we have an expertise in energy law. I wanted to introduce the panelists, but I guess we've already heard from Rexi and Rose, and those were excellent presentations. So let me start maybe first with Rexi. Keep you talking here. Sure. You gave us a great background on Thailand. I mean, I some of the statistics you gave about your market share were really impressive, but this new Tiger series seems to have some good attributes that might work well in the warm country here that we have. So thanks for pointing that out to us. Maybe you could give me a little idea about your views on the market right now here in Thailand. Is it moving? Is there upside potential? Has COVID caused the status quo to slow down a little bit, or is there a reversion away? Well, what are your general views if you can share that, Reggie?
Yeah, sure. First of all, I'd love to summarize a little bit about the Thailand market. I'm not a local team in Thailand, and most of them probably from the secondary research. And as far as I know, the market has been quite mature in developed. It has mix of energy, including the commercial energy and including the natural gas or coal, and also the renewable energy. They mixed and combined. And at this stage, I believe from the policy side, there are a combination of the PPA or private PPA segmentations. And also there are boost in the rooftop markets. And from this perspective, although this is a special COVID-19 period and it has slowed down the global PV industry, but I believe Thailand, first of all, can be suffered less comparing to the US or the European markets. From a supply perspective, here in Thailand is closer to the major module providers and the tracker or the mounting system providers, which is China. And it benefits from this kind of logistic fee. And under this logistic soaring environment, I believe Thailand can benefit from this kind of cost saving. And I also would like to share more about my perspective of future development in a more technical perspective. First, I have summarized that I believe Thailand is relatively a warm country. So I think it needs to adopt the anti-products which have better temperature coefficient. And also, meanwhile, Thailand in the northern area, I Googled it, I'm not sure if it's 100% right. In northern area, there are more mountains over there. So it's very similar to China's southern area. So we'll have to, in mountain area, because there are huge slopes, so it is very good to use relatively smaller modules, smaller, but high power and high efficient. In the southern area of Thailand, there are more general land for modules. So there will be more suitable for our big modules, like 78 pieces. It can help with the lens. And I want to point out one specific angle for N-type advantage, which is it has better power generation ability. And therefore, we can use even smaller angle of installation, even flat. So we can reach the same power generation for the whole plant. And by having the smaller angle, the space between arrays could be smaller. So it can save more space. And the relatively road cost can be even lower. And also the mounting system and the when the slope angle is getting smaller, the potential mechanical load risk will be smaller and the mounting system cost will decrease. And generally it can largely decrease the whole EPC cost. And that is something that I want to share with the Thailand market from a technical perspective. And also for the future market of Thailand, as I said, it's more challenging to install PV panels in northern area, considering there will be trees and mountains. It is not very good environment. So the area, it can be very limited. So I think in the future, there will be more rooftop projects and also the water projects. And there are more and more, our Tiger New products has also focused on dual glass modules, which have better waterproof ability and fits the projects on water area, and which can, I think, perfectly match the local environment of Thailand. And that is my idea.
Yeah, I appreciate all of those. I think we'll have to check with Khun Khamsin and maybe Fabian as well about the mountains up north, but I think you're pretty correct there.
Okay.
Really interesting discussion from the larger to smaller motor variety, even in your Thai market. So I appreciate that feedback, and I hope folks were listening here. But maybe Rose, you've spoken already. Great presentation. Thanks for giving that today. Let me follow up with you. It seems like ArcTech really has developed some tracking that is next generation, and it's really exciting to see how the tracking in the SCADA system, you can have good upload to really drive some efficiency. So I'm excited to see how you guys develop that. I think it's important in a country like Thailand and in Myanmar, when you have such diversity from north to south, to have the variability in those systems. So I'm glad to see that improvement. Reishi was sort of speculating on percentages, ground mounted, floating, and rooftop. Rose, how are you seeing this develop? Towards the end of your presentation, you started to talk about some of your preferences or some of your ideas. Do you have longer range views on that for Thailand?
Yeah, I think we have the quite same opinion with Reishi. And so yes, because the landscape of Thailand is quite complicated. It's mountain, and Thailand is a very mature market so far. It has developed solar for many years. So for currently years, it doesn't have newly published like government FIT. So, but it still have the like private PPAs. It still have the private PPAs, and for the ground scale projects, it may not be like a rapidly increased the quantities in future years. But also, like Reishi said, and there's still have the potential for the rooftops for the small size of the projects. And also, I think there's a big market which is the new repowering projects. So compared to the existing projects, they are mostly built with the fixed structure, with the mono sizes, low efficiency modules. And by using the tracking system, the high efficiency modules, and bifacial modules, it honors, it can have the return on investment rapidly increased, and also the increase of the power generation, it will be magnificent in the rest years of the PPAs. We still have the very big confidence in Thailand market, and also we have I think this market has big potential in developing solar still, and ArcTech we were determined to develop like long-term partnership in Thailand, so we will come to approach us.
Those are good comments, Rose, and I hope our participants today are listening. You know, these PPAs are for a lengthy period of time, and there's a lot of learning to be done. And yeah, in particular, with your equipment selection up front, you're going to learn how to become more efficient over time. I think both you and Reishi have been very clear on that. How about a little bit of a surprise question? I know you guys have a solar carport that you are working on or worked on. Maybe you could tell me a little bit about that product. I didn't hear it in your slide presentation. So is there any information you can share with us on that?
Yeah, thanks for the introduction. Yeah, and solar carport actually is like new trend. It's developing very rapidly these years. And it also has a big market and the potential. So usually this like a turning to a locking port into like a solar PV station. So it's like energy conservation, and it can do like traditional carport. They can product the vehicles. It can improve the internal climate of the vehicles. And also it can provide output electrical for this site, or for the maybe like the facility nearby. And also optionally they will have a unique function, because it can turn into this parking lot into a EV charger station. If you are using like it's a parking like the new energy cars, it can be charged from the project itself. So this I think this has a big potential market.
Well, that's hopeful. That's good news.
Yeah.
Yeah, sure. I imagine you're seeing a little more of that in China than in the Thai market, but we'd be looking forward to that. Maybe one last comment from you today. Any developments in the planning for the Thailand market and expectations that you have? Maybe a top one or two or three guesses for the Thai market, or do you think you've covered that already today?
Yeah, we already like rented one in Southeast Asia market and also in the Asia Pacific, and we determined to keep that place. Yeah, and we're looking forward to develop together with our partners in Thailand. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, great. Well, you're obviously a big name here, and we appreciate you having in town. Let me move on to Spencer then. Okay, Spencer Zhu, you're at GoodWe. We haven't heard from your company today. We have heard from you in the past. We know your good works. We know that you have you're a leading manufacturer of the photovoltaic inverters. So that's interesting. You've got a lot of home, commercial, and industrial solutions that you guys offer in the marketplace. You know, from your point of view, what's maybe, I'll use the word missing, but you know, what could the Thai market use to boost installed capacity? Regulatory, legal, more lawyers. We always like more lawyers from my side. So regulatory, legal, market incentives. What would you be looking for, Spencer, if you had to put up some ideas?
Well, thank you for Reggie and Rose for their excellent speech. From our side, I think the regulation and the legal framework are already leading the whole society to increase the solar power investment in Thailand. For example, Thailand has several plans and roadmaps in place, which includes like the gas plan, oil plan, and the energy efficiency plan, and the alternative energy development plan, which integrates the smart grid plan. So Thailand is certainly moving in the right direction with respect to boosting its renewable energy production. And to enhance the renewable energy growth in Thailand includes the market incentives to encourage the renewable energy investment. I think Thailand should consider to include the active involvement of all stakeholders in the policy formulation. Therefore, we should ensure that the strong public as well as the stakeholder support to boost the renewable energy. And with the falling cost of this installation and the solar system, for example, the larger size and the higher power of the solar panels has driven a new trend in the PV industry. And the larger power level power panels benefits for the lower the system cost and then further lower the LCOE, so which is one of the major concerns of the investors. GoodWe, as an inverter manufacturer, the technological breakthroughs of the inverters are actually driven by the PV module development and also the target of to fulfill the target of lower the LCOE. So the most typical technology breakthrough is to increase the inverter power level. And so fewer inverters will be used in the large scale solar plants. And for the DC side of the inverters, the maximum DC input voltage are increasing to have more PV panels in one string, and which can help to save the DC cable investment. And the AC output voltage is also increased accordingly. So it can help to lower the cable cost, cable investment and cable loss. Another technology improvement is that the string inverters are more having more protective functions. It is also integrated in the inverters such as the SVG functions and NTPID and the SPD protections. So in the future, the string inverters can be more functional and save the cost of their external devices. Well, that's all from my side.
Well, thank you, Spencer. I mean, I think, you know, you and Reishi and Rose are aligned a little bit here, but I'm not as familiar with the technology. And so when you talk about the increase in the inverter power level, Are you able to keep your costs down on that, or is there corresponding price increases you're capable of generating that power? What's the trade-off I get here if I'm making the investment?
Well, for the same size of a large scale PV system, when we are increasing the power level of the inverters, we can actually step down the decrease the numbers of the inverters we use. So actually we are in decreasing the cost of the inverter investment.
Yeah, that's a good point. I think that goes to Rose's, you know, SCADA and optics. You know, as long as you can track that and understand the savings over time, this really does start to get more cost efficient. And so I think the three of you that have presented really are presenting the case very well today. So thank you for that, Spencer. Let me move on and see if we can talk to our newest member. I'll admit, we're probably neighbors in Bangkok, even though Bangkok is a very big city. I have a feeling we live and work near each other. But Fabian Chetefaux, you're at LYS Energy Group. You're the country manager here. I believe that LYS is the first energy independent producer that was in Singapore, right?
Right, indeed.
Right. You guys offer a whole range of services from commercial, industrial, and public sites. And so I think a big company, mature company, running well. I'd be interested to hear about some of the opportunities you're seeing in Thailand. We haven't spoken on a panel before. And so I'll be interested in hearing about the opportunities you're seeing. And then maybe you could talk a little bit about some of the challenges or things you'd like to see folks work on over the next months and years. Is that a fair question, or do you need a little more pointedness to it?
It's a fair question. I will just start presenting shortly. Lis Energy has been, like you said, started in Singapore, so it's one of the first IPP that mostly develop all around Asia and that are coming to Thailand now. So thanks to what Ross said, indeed, the market here evolved a lot. The market here is not exactly what it used to be 5 years ago. The knowledge about, for example, the clients know the PPA better, the bank, local and international banking industry, they do understand the PPA. EPC market are becoming mature, like we understood the price of building is decreasing, which is a good thing and help develop the market. So it does help in general to increase indeed the potential to implement a solar rooftop from small to bigger rooftop to ground mounted, even doing floating is developing a lot. I really see that as a future trend. But indeed COVID brought us something new that we need to the client want more flexibility. And the bank industry want less risk. So to bring more flexibility, at some point we need to do like a really tailor-made solution, working on the duration of the contract, working on the capacity we install. We need to be very accurate. As for the banking, the investments, we need to mitigate the risk while combining different industrial projects. To reassure them.
Yeah, those are good points. Could I think I was seeing you drift towards this concept, but I'm interested, you know, having dealt with the regulatory bodies in Singapore and having fairly fast queues and oftentimes having very responsive regulators, you know, how would you describe the project application process in Thailand? Are you getting the hang of it, or are there still complexities that you need to deal with, or
I think Comsen could agree with me that the licensing process used to be very difficult here. It did improve a lot. The one-stop solution did help. Application for smaller than 1 megawatt peak and above 1 megawatt peak is still time-consuming, but it's way much more predictable. So that does help. As far as also for the BOI process, we do have BOI incentive that allow us to finance projects. They have been extended until next year, so we can continue to have visibility on financing the project and on the timeline of construction. So it's a pretty positive note on the application process approval, to be honest.
Well, that's great to hear. And I'm glad to hear that those BOI changes, which are more of a corporate administrative process, but allow foreign direct invest companies to take advantage of certain opportunities here. You know, for anyone doing business here or for having to align that BOI, I find is very helpful. And so I'm glad you brought that up today. And I hope the folks heard us say that loud and clear. We appreciate the assistance from the BOI. Maybe one last piece. I know the other folks have had a little longer to speak, but any thoughts on appliances related to energy storage, or is that not an area you're focusing on much these days, or is this something that you're looking to advance the market in at all, Fabien?
It's always something that we need to focus in. We were working on solar when the market were not ready, but to be ready too. Right now, I wouldn't say that Thailand is really ready to start energy storage, but it's same for many other countries in Asia. It's a good time to start pilot projects. And when we are talking about midterm, long term, it's obvious that it will be a major concern, and that it will be a future trend. There is like some difficulty that we need to solve first with, I think, the governments, like how to implement net metering, how to adapt the network, to do forecast and production, and to do a real-time network analysis. But as soon as it's done, I think we will be able to move forward on energy storage.
That's right. I think you've hit it. Net metering is big. I was hoping Rose was going to say that my roof, my carport solar was going to have storage in it so I could have 100% usable rooftop car parking solar, but maybe not yet. Maybe someday soon, but I'll have to find a parking space outside because I'm in a building. So I need you guys to help me charge my car on my own. So meet my own personal goals for carbon emissions. But thank you for that, Fabien. I've noticed the rooftop behind you. I assume that's maybe product your company has done elsewhere, but pretty significant stuff when you look at the magnitude of scale we're talking about here. These are the types of projects that ArcTech, LYS Energy, Jinko, Goodwe are doing, and they're massive and they generate a lot of power. And this is the future. So if you're not used to seeing that, everyone get ready. Here it comes. We're going to see a lot of those. And maybe we won't see them from the street as much, but they're out there. One of my favorite speakers today, Kamsan Kenyota from Total Energies, I'm going to shift over to you. We've spoken once or twice in the past. You know, I think we need to say this. You are in a company that's living in all three worlds of fossil fuel, of LNG, and of renewables. And so COP26 probably had a lot of lessons for you, but at the same time, you personally are a real thought leader in Thailand and have been moving this solar market along with the helps of the folks on this call. So it's good to see you again. I'm always interested in hearing your take on how the processes have improved since you started. That's good to hear. I think Fabien sort of echoed that. How the PPA and the banking is maturing along with that. But I'd like to hear sort of what you're seeing from a technological breakthrough, or things that you're seeing from systems intelligence that have taken hold in Thailand. I know you know the worldwide market, but I'd want to see what's taking hold here. And I want to see if Rose's cloud application on the SCADA system is going to allow us to all, you know, talk into our iPhone and tell everything to get up to speed. But anything you can share with us, Kamsan?
Thanks, Joseph. Well, talking about the technologies, actually, first of all, thanks to our friends here from the PV module inverters or mounting structure. They always offer, you know, the new technologies to the market and also to the Thailand. Well, another side that we need to look into is on those applications. Let's say, in my point of view, somebody may heard that recently in Thailand we have those SPP hybrid firm. It means that it's a hybrid between solar and energy storage, battery storage, let's say. So this application will allow the solar hybrid system to be able to, you know, supply the power even in those night times, let's say. So this is the firm contracts, which is the developer can produce and confirm that okay, they can produce to meet the maximum capacity. Yeah, that they sign the contracts. Other than that, I think we need to talk about those EGAT projects. Yeah, the EGAT 14 project is a hybrid project again with the hydropower. So EGAT, they will install the solar floating system and connect into the hybrid system, which is okay. They will monitor and forecast of those the weather, and then they will mix with the how to produce the power with the hydro dam. So that's kind of thing. Actually, I believe that they have already COD for one dam, which is right now they are on the commissioning, right? So in the future they will have another 8 dam, which is if this application is work well, it means that we can manage the power which is it will also reduce the LCOE, so it's be good for the industry as well. So, and in the midterm and long term, I think we can talk about the ERC sandbox program. ERC stands for the Energy Regulatory Commission, which is they have those sandbox program, which is I think they set this program since 2019. And right now, some of projects have already, commercialized and by the way, commercialize on the testing, let's say. The ERC will get a lot of the information, on those sandbox projects, and it can be used for to change the regulations, which is, it will allow the new business model and new technologies to come to Thailand and boost those of the capacity of the solar. For example, we are going to have like a peer-to-peer contracts, let's say, and net metering or net billing also one of the project that is on the testing. And other than that, like the energy storage and EV charger, load aggregator supply and load aggregator, which is they can manage the peak and off peak, and they can manage how to produce and sell at a really high price on some of the load profile. Yeah, that is something that I think is will boot up. After the sandbox project success and ERC, they can set up the new regulation for Thailand, and suddenly we can have like more than 1 gigawatt per year for Thailand with those new applications. Yeah.
Yeah, those are great examples you brought up. And for those of you listening, EGAT is the Electrical Generating Authority here, and ERC is the arm. The sandbox programs have been really beneficial. You know, again, as a lawyer listening to this, I hope that there is an information sharing. And I think Rose brought it up from her applications point of view, but there's a lot of learning to be done here. And I wonder if as you get towards the equator and as you move more south, the learnings are different than as you install up in the north. And I think this is a theme. So it'll be interesting to see how the learnings are specific to Thailand, but then become universal. And so Khun Khamsan, I appreciate that. How about if we do this, Khun Khamsan, do you have any final comments on either Fabian's panel or on the earlier questions that we heard that you would want to add information that I forgot to ask about? Maybe close it up for us with the last question, or are you okay as is?
Well, in my point of view, yeah, I think the licensing, as Fabian has mentioned, would be the permission and licensing would be something that we can make it more easy. Let's say for Thailand, it's you put a lot of the capacity here. Yeah. If we can solve that problem. Yeah.
Yeah, and I think it's important for you to say that because Fabian and I can say that and say it's much faster where we come from, or we can say these other things. And we're not saying that as an attack or as an insult, but it really, the application process for the five of you is critically important, in particular when you're going to have supply chain constrained enterprises and you're really trying to plan differently, right? And so for those of you listening who have folks or friends in the regulatory areas, you know, that it's an ongoing concern that's improving, but any help we can get for the facilitation and speeding up of permitting and processing and licensing is greatly appreciated by this industry. So maybe let me try and finish up here and then hand the panel back to Claire. We've had some very good discussion again today, as was expected. I want to thank GoodWee, Jinko, ArcTech, NeoVenture, and the Solar Talks webinar folks for doing this. I think this is a good topic. Solar market potential, status quo, and the forecast of 2025 and beyond. We've heard topics on that. We've heard preferences and some of the views on rooftop versus ground versus water. And I think you know, the angle from north to south is an interesting discussion, and the types of motors you're going to have vary in the country. And so even inside Thailand, we have equipment suppliers and sellers offering different products. And so you have to listen to the folks, you know, who are talking to you here, because there is regional expertise happening very quickly here, and that can drive costs very differently. We've also heard that, you know, carbon emission reductions are coming. And so hopefully the sandbox is going to show the ERC the way to help maybe get some relief selling back into the grid. We've heard that mentioned a couple of times, maybe looking at ways to improve that process. But they're exciting times, and it's clear that this panel today really is are the folks with the know-how and the experience. And so I'm going to keep close with you all. I'm going to join your chats on LinkedIn and see what you guys are doing, because it's really moving fast now. And I think COP26 really got us all excited to keep going. So on behalf of NeoVenture, on behalf of the folks on this call, I'd like to thank you all for listening today. And Claire, I'm going to hand it back to you. I believe we have one more presenter today, right?
Thank you, Joseph. I think this is panel discussion is fruitful, and I think our audience can benefit from a lot. And next, let's welcome Mrs. Spencer Xu from GoodWee to bring his bring their solution to the Thailand market. Let's welcome.
Hello, everyone. My name is Spencer, solution engineer from GoodWee Solar Academy. I'm now supporting Australia and Southeast Asia for the PV system solution. Today, I'm glad to introduce you GoodWee's commercial and industrial solution and some applications in Southeast Asia. Today's sharing will be carried out from the following four aspects. First of all, let me give you a brief introduction of GoodWee about who we are and what we do. GoodWee is a global leading inverter manufacturer, but we are actually more than that. Our vision is to create a new era of the smart energy. And to achieve that, we've installed over 2 million units of inverters and have helped save over 26 million tons of carbon dioxide. GoodWee starts our smart energy journey since 2010. In the past 10 years, we've developed in a dramatic speed and become a famous brand trusted by customers. We were listed on Shanghai Stock Exchange last year, and our business is keep expanding and growing. As a global company, we have branches and sales and service centers all over the world so that all our clients can be served in time. We also have two R&D centers and two factories to ensure product innovation as well as production and delivery. Our global sales revenue breaks through $200 million last year. As a well-known inverter manufacturer, GoodWee has won many awards recognized in the PV industry. For example, GoodWee is the only solar inverter manufacturer to win the TUV Rainline All Quality Matters Award for six consecutive years. We also awarded by Woodmakers as number one hybrid storage inverter supplier. Next, let's look at some typical commercial and industrial system solutions and applications of GoodWee. Here is a system specialized for the commercial rooftops. In this system, the generated solar power will be consumed by the load first, and the rest power will be fed into the grid. In the commercial and industrial scenarios, normally we will have multiple inverters. So we can use the SEC1000 here, which is a communication box for the load consumption monitoring and the export power limit control. And GoodWee also offers the free online monitoring platform, which is called the SIMS portal. It is short for the Smart Energy Management System. And it's a smart tool to help customers monitor their power plants in a visualized way and help maintenance. And GoodWee also offers the system solution for the low voltage grid, for example, in Latin America and in Southeast Asia. And in large commercial projects, we also offer products and system solution for the high voltage scenario. In the high voltage scenarios, the inverter output will be connected to the transformer first and then connected to the high voltage distributed network. For the communication methods, we can choose the power line communication to save the cable investment. Here are our main products for the commercial and industrial application from 25 kilowatt to 136 kilowatt. We have the SMT series that have three MPVTs, works from 25 to 36 kilowatt. And we also have the MT series that offers both the low voltage and high voltage models. And for the HT series, it has more MPPTs that's ranging from 73 to 136 kilowatt. GoodWee commercial and industrial products are featured with the full load operation at 50 degree and up to 150 DC oversizing and up to 115 AC overloading. We are also integrated, we also offers integrated arc fault circuit interpreter and the power line communication. And we also have an ultimate high power inverter, which is the HT1500 volt series. It is specially designed for the large commercial and industrial application, as well as the large utility projects. This model is fully compatible with the mainstream high power modules, such as the 182 millimeter and 210 millimeter PV modules. So the HT1500 volt series also offers the second generation power line communication and the smart IV curve diagnosis, as well as the SVG functions. Now let's look at in details how GoodWee inverters to be compatible with the high current and bifacial modules. As far as we can see, the 182 millimeter wafer has been widely used in the utility projects. And there's an evolution of the PV modules with the larger solar cell size and higher power level. So it brings challenges for the whole PV industry. And for the as an inverter manufacturer, we need to increase the maximum input current and also the maximum short circuit current to be compatible with the high power PV modules. And our inverter could fully adapt it to 182 millimeter PV modules. We can see there's a mainstream 182 millimeter manufacturers, for example, the Jinko, which has the Tigo Pro series. So here we can see that their short circuit current is about 13 to 14 ampere. And we found that even the one that has the largest short circuit current is also below 15 ampere, while our inverter can support maximum 15 ampere input current per string. And it has already been a mainstream combination of the 182 modules and HT inverters. So we can say that we are fully compatible to the 182 millimeter PV modules. And in the commercial and industrial applications, we also have to connect with the 210 millimeter PV modules. So that we have, and here we can see that for the 210 millimeter PV modules, we have the solution for that connecting only one string for each MPPTs, so that we can have a maximum input current of 30 ampere. So here we have an example that we can see the short circuit current for the module is 18.52 ampere, and the open circuit voltage is 41.5 at the STC. And after some calculations, we can find that we will have 22 PV modules per string, and the 12 strings are connected. So as a result, we still have DC oversizing of about 132%. So we are also can be compatible with the 210 millimeter PV modules. Next, let's have a look at the product features of Goodwee commercial and industrial products. So Goodwee inverters can adapt to the multiple environments. For the multi-angle rooftops, we have 12 MPPTs. So it is very flexible for the system design. And Goodwee inverters also features for the full load operation at high temperature and can also adapt to the coastal areas. For example, because the HT series is certified with the C5 protection level. And for the lightning prone areas, integrated type 1 SPD on the DC side is also available to be chosen. As we've mentioned before, that Goodwee inverters has a good heat dissipation performance. And I believe it is very meaningful for the Thailand because it has a very warm climate. And we have a very reasonable heat dissipation path. And it is integrated with six powerful NMB fans so that we can keep the full load operation at 45 degrees for the HT series. And for the SMT and MT series, we can keep the full load operation at 50 degrees. And as we know, there is a hazard called arc failure that could result in the fire accidents. And Goodwee commercial products has an optional choice of the arc failure protection with the second generation AFCI level protection that is compliant with the UL and IEC standards. Goodwee also developed the smart IV curve diagnosis, which is a useful tool for the operation and maintenance for large commercial and industrial projects. It can support up to 20 error types and can save the detection time down to the minutes level. So it is more efficient both in time and cost. Actually, we also developed anti-PID functions. And so in the evenings, the PID function will automatically be activated. So the inverter will add a reverse 600 volt between the module's negative and the PE to repair the PID problems happened during the daytime. Goodwee commercial products also can support the wide branch connection to reduce the DC cable investment. And for the communication methods, we also offer very flexible communication methods. For example, we can either choose the LCD screen or use the app called the Solar Go via Bluetooth or Wi-Fi. Well, now let's look at how Goodwee inverters ensures reliability and safety. To ensure our products can have a long life cycle, we have diverse tests both internally and externally. For example, we have the IP protection test conducted by the TUV, and we also have very strict quality management procedure in factory. Here, as you can see through the pictures, Goodwee has a very strict control and production line. We have the self-developed AT test to make sure our inverter is 100% ready before shipment. And we also have an aging test to ensure our inverter are reliable in the extreme hot weather conditions. So thank you. That's all for from Goodway. So if you have any questions, please feel free to contact us.
Thank you, Spencer. And thanks to everyone for joining our today's webinar. And we appreciate all speakers' great support and valuable comments for this market. Especially thanks to Joseph for help us to control our schedule of the webinar. And we will share the recording and the PowerPoint slides used of today's webinar to your registration email by the end of next week. Should you have any questions, please be free to contact our team through the email address showing on the slide right now. Please make sure to follow Solar Talks webinar on LinkedIn and get our firsthand webinar update information. Thank you all of you. See you next time. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye. See you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Have a nice day.